People passionately long for the times when justice will be throned in might and every hurt will be healed. Christians believe that God will eventually do justice on a worldwide scale. So, how will God do justice and how does He do it today? Stay with us as we take a fresh look at four well-known parables of Jesus. Welcome to an interactive and live study of the Word of God and the life of Jesus. Cross Connection is about us studying together, and we would love to hear from you how Cross Connection has affected your life. So get in touch with us by writing to us at crossconnection@hopetv.org. Or you can always leave your comment about how Cross Connection is affecting your life on our Facebook page. If you're watching us live right now, joining our discussion is as easy as picking up your phone and sending us a text. Send your texts anytime during the discussion to 707-200-1075. Or you can join our ongoing conversation on Facebook anytime, anywhere in the world. We want to connect with you. You know, last week we had a very exciting discussion on Jesus' apocalyptic prophecy and its implication in our lives. We learned that Jesus deliberately refused to give the disciples the sign that they had asked for. We also learned that the time of the judgment and His second coming cannot be calculated and cannot be foreseen. But we can and we should be ready. And that readiness can be achieved only by living all the time in such a way that the arrival of the kingdom of God will be received as not as disaster, but a time of praise and real joy. Well, after Jesus stated that no one knows the day or the hour, not even the angels, He gave four parables that summarize Jesus' advice on how to be ready. Those parables are the faithful and the evil servant, the wise and foolish girls, the talents, and the sheep and the goats. All of these parables have something in common. You know, every time on Cross Connection, we ask you a question and we are looking forward to your answers. So today, we would like to take a closer look at four parables of Jesus that emphasize that no one knows the hour and they also. Those parables also demonstrate what it means to share the gospel of the kingdom. So our question today for you is, what are some ways that we can personally share the gospel on a daily basis? Connect with us by simply texting to us or post your comments on Facebook. We are looking forward to your answers. And I'm excited because we are joined today by Jennifer, Elisa, and Jitesh. So tell me, how was your week?
Hectic,
okay.
Yeah.
Despite that the week is hectic, you're still here to study the Word of God.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
It is a blessing, that's great. And I'm also thankful to you that you're joining us wherever you are. And please just be a part of this conversation because we want people to be involved, don't we?
Yes,
absolutely.
We do.
Okay.
Totally.
Okay. And we have a lot of material to cover today. So let us just start. And Jitesh, if you could say a prayer for us.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, open our hearts, Lord, open our minds, and may we receive you, Lord. May we learn something today. This is all about you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
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 Okay, so I'm excited because in Matthew chapter 24, and our last week's study was very interesting because we actually received a few comments, how people commented that they actually, they saw something very different in Matthew chapter 24, mm-hmm. something that they have never seen before. And if you would like to join to watch that episode, you can always go to our website. And on our website, go to watch episodes, and you'll be able to find that episode on Matthew chapter 24. There is one significant detail in Matthew chapter 24, and Jitesh was with us last week. So that detail is recorded in Matthew chapter 24, verse 14. And Jennifer, what does that verse tell us?
And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations, and then the end will come.
Okay, so this is the key text. We may say that this is the key text of Matthew chapter 24, because it says, and then the gospel will be preached, and then the end will come. And then there is also another very important point. It is actually recorded several times. In verse 36 and also verse 42. But let's just read verse 42. And Elisa, if you could read it for us, please. 42.
Therefore, be on the alert, for you do not know which day your Lord is coming.
And in verse 36, Jesus repeats the same thing. But of that day and hour, no one knows. So, but immediately after that, Jesus delivers four parables. And those four parables, they need to be seen through the light of previous chapter, which is Matthew chapter 24. Mm-hmm. And let's get to those parables.
All right.
So we are in Matthew chapter 24, verses 45 to verse 51. And Jitesh, if you could read it for us, please.
Who then is a faithful and wise servant, whom his master made ruler over his household to give them food in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his master, when he comes, will find so doing. Assuredly, I say to you that he will make him ruler over all his goods. But if that evil servant says in his heart, my master is delaying his coming, and begins to beat his fellow servants and to eat and drink with the drunkards, the master of that servant will come on a day when he is not looking for him, and an hour that he is not aware of, and will cut him into two and appoint him his portion with the hypocrites. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth.
Oh, wow.
Graphic.
Wow. Yeah.
Very graphic description, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what do you see in this parable? And tell me, what do you see in this parable? Elisa?
Well, I mean, I feel like, why does he come back just at the moment? It's almost like he's waiting to catch him. You know what I mean?
Mm.
Like, oh, now he's all relaxed and like eating and drinking and doing his thing, and I'll come back right then. It almost seems like vindictive. I feel like a lot of people look at God, they're just like, God's just waiting to catch us at a wrong moment, when that's not really the point of, but it kind of jumps out at me, like it almost seems that way. It seems like, mm-hmm. you know, if your parent did that, you'd think, oh, you were trying to catch me when I wasn't ready for you, you know, or.
It's like examination week, yeah?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's like, I'm taking an exam,
quiz,
and like,
you know,
here's another quiz.
Like, you know, and we like to think, oh, our teachers are just waiting to get us, you know, they don't want us to succeed, but you know, how can we look at it differently? Because obviously that's not what God is. That's not his character.
Mm-hmm.
But it still seems like that. So, and especially after he comes and he cuts him in half and so graphic, it just seems really harsh.
Okay, and let's look at this parable now through the previous chapter, which is chapter 24. No one knows about the day and the hour.
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, you're entrusted with something.
Well, I guess my reaction to that parable was a little different because it felt like justice to me. I mean, if an evil servant knew that the master was coming,
mm-hmm.
he's going to pretend to be nice to all of the other servants. And that's not necessarily justice to the people who are being abused.
Mm-hmm.
So I saw that this parable for me showed how God cares about how we treat people. We can't treat people poorly and think we have a good relationship with God, and we can't pretend that we're going to treat everybody well and expect God not to find out about it.
Mm-hmm.
I agree very much so with Jennifer, because it's the fact of what are you doing when nobody is watching? That's what I think God is really trying to say in this is, even though people may not have eyes on you, you know what you're doing and you need to really focus on that. So.
Mm-hmm. So we see those two slaves, like mm-hmm. these two slaves. First slave is a just slave, isn't it? Isn't mm-hmm. he? Or faithful servant.
Yes. Yeah.
Faithful servant. He's the one who was entrusted with what?
With more.
Yeah, but what is he?
In charge of the household.
He's in charge of the entire household.
Wow.
So think about how God entrusts us now, because this is what Jesus mm-hmm. was talking about.
Sure.
He knew that this is the end of his ministry.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He was talking to his disciples.
Mm-hmm.
So his disciples were listening to that. And he was saying, you know what? there is a king who is going to leave you, mm-hmm. and he will depart. And he entrusted you with this, his entire household, mm-hmm. because everyone is created in God's
image.
Everyone, we are the kingdom of God.
Sure.
So that's why he says, no, I want you to do something now. This is amazing.
Yes. It's also simple. Like, I like that it says, in my version, whom his master put in charge of his household to give them their food at the proper time. Mm-hmm. Blessed is that slave whom his master finds so doing. Like, we know the food is like the word of God, and we're just preaching the word, we're sharing. And I've read recently, I don't remember where it was, something about how we don't always know how the word is going to affect someone else. It may seem like the driest like crop, and we want to reap, and we're like, oh, we want them to respond. We want them to, like, wow, that's amazing. I want to accept the word, and just, but we need to share it anyway, even if it's not the reaction that we want to have. Mm-hmm. So, like, who knows what the rest of the story is? It's just two verses.
Excellent. Excellent.
I thought it was interesting that this story wasn't about sharing the gospel. To me, it was about how you treat others. It wasn't, you know, the servant wasn't, you know, preaching the good news when I got back. It was the servant was beating his fellow servants and, you know, becoming a glutton. Basically, what we most often see in, you know, cultures where people just try to take over other people and treat them poorly. So that's what God was angry about.
Yes.
So when Jesus talks about this parable, he says, no, you talk about justice. Mm-hmm. Now I'll tell you who can do the justice mm-hmm. today. You talk about justice in the future.
Yeah.
But now I would like you to experience this justice today. And that justice starts from you.
From yes. you.
So yep. Well, I wanted to add something.
Please.
Was that, you know, the point that stuck out to me the most was that the fact that, you know, we feel like in order to be in charge of something, we need to be really good and be really trying to show our boss or whoever that we're trying to impress, look, I can do all these great things. Mm-hmm. Give me power. Give me a point.
Yes.
You know. But what God is trying to say is it's the small things that count. It's the little things that you need to continue to do daily, whether you get credit for it or not. And those are the people that I'm looking for to be in charge of what's going on.
Beautiful.
That's a really
continue
good point.
Continue faithfully to do.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Yes.
Yep. Exactly.
Beautiful. Okay, we will continue discussing the next parables, because next parables bring even more light and additional light to this parable. That is probably why Jesus gave four parables.
Yes.
Because he knew that they were not getting it from just one parable.
That's right.
So that's why it needed to be reemphasized. Something needed to be reemphasized. So don't go anywhere. Okay?
Okay.
As we take a break, think about today's question and share your thoughts with us. What are some ways that we can personally share the gospel on a daily basis? Send your text anytime during the discussion to 707-200-1075, or you can join our ongoing conversation on Facebook anytime. Welcome back to Cross Connection. It is simply amazing when Jesus reveals the mysteries of the kingdom of God, and he also tells us that, first of all, we need to remember that no one knows the hour, but we can be ready. Yes. And
Amen.
In these parables, he talks about how we can be ready. In the first parable, we read about, and there were two main opinions that were said here, that we are entrusted with God's word, mm-hmm. but we are also entrusted with this with this responsibility mm-hmm. to take care of those who are around us. Mm-hmm. And the second parable that Jesus tells us, this is very interesting because he didn't just say one parable. Mm-hmm. Did
I
he?
Love that he uses so many
exactly.
venues and
exactly.
examples.
And especially in this point, when he talked about Matthew chapter 24, he said, no, I know that it will be a little bit hard for you to understand. That's why I give to you four parables. So let's talk about our second parable, and it's in Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 all the way through verse 15. But I would like Jennifer, mm-hmm. to 13, but I would like Jennifer to summarize this story for us.
Yes. Okay, so this is sort of an exciting story because it's about a wedding, and there were 10 girls, and they were, you know, I guess part of the wedding party, bridesmaids, and they were waiting for the bridegroom, because my understanding is at these types of weddings, they normally happen like later in the evening or at night, and the bridegroom would come from his home to the bride's home to, you know, pick her up and take her back to meet his family, and then the whole wedding party would go along. And so these girls were waiting for the bridegroom to come, and five of the girls had, you know, all of them had lamps. Five of the girls had lamps, you know, with oil and with extra oil, and the other five did not have enough oil. Mm-hmm. And when the five that did not have enough oil ran out of their oil, or were starting to notice they were going to run out, they asked the girls who had brought extra oil if they could have some. And the girls were like, you know, really sorry, but we can't help you out with this. You need to go and buy some more. Mm-hmm. And so the bridegroom came, and the girls who didn't have the oil, you know, when they went to the house to try to go into the wedding party, he said, you know, I'm sorry, but I don't know you, so I can't let you in.
Yes. Mm. And then in verse 11, we read, afterward, the other virgins came, also saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. Mm-hmm. And then he said, but he answered, assuredly, I say to you, I do not
know you. I don't know you.
Wow.
Okay. And then there is a question, and or maybe just encouragement of Jesus himself. He says in verse 13, and Jennifer, what does he say in verse 13?
It says, watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming.
Wow.
Well, okay.
Wow, that's powerful.
It is powerful. So we see five wise women or the young ladies, mm-hmm. and five not so smart. Jennifer, you made a very interesting point. You said that it's bridesmaids.
Yes.
Why did you say bridesmaids?
Well, you know, I guess maybe that was me taking a little bit of a liberty because okay. you know they're in a wedding party, so I'm okay. calling them bridesmaids.
Okay.
But they were a part of a wedding party, and so you know they had like a role in the wedding, and that's normally what bridesmaids
you
do.
Know, now I'm going to tell you something very interesting, and I hope you will understand me correctly. This is very fascinating, because our previous parable, what were the main characters? Were they male or female?
Male.
Men. Yeah.
Men, yes.
Yeah.
So they were men. In this parable, Jesus talks about five wise and five not so wise, and that they were waiting. Mm-hmm. You told us very, very, it's very true that the bridegroom would most of the time, he would go to the place mm-hmm. where his bride, like wife-to-be mm-hmm. was. So he would go to that house, take her and come back mm-hmm. to his house. Mm-hmm. And this is where they would have their party.
Right. Wow.
So where is this party happening in this parable?
At his house.
At his house.
At his house. So where were these ten ladies waiting for him? Like, what was the place where they were in for him?
Presumably at her house.
At the bride's house.
Why?
Well,
no.
With her,
just
I guess
you know.
Why? Because they're ladies. You think about ladies, and then we immediately think about them being with the bride. No.
Were they supposed to be escorting the groom?
No, they probably were at groom's house.
Oh, were they at the groom's house, just not inside?
Waiting for
they
him?
Were waiting outside
Where
the groom's
he?
House?
Getting
because
the bride.
He went to get his bride
uh-huh.
and come back.
Uh-huh.
Oh, okay, I didn't
oh.
think about
that.
Are we still
yeah.
there?
Yeah.
I okay. envision them like kind of in the middle of the street.
That's
okay,
yeah. that's kind of like
yeah, but then they invited. Randomly. Look at this. Look at this play. Look at this verse 6.
Okay.
And at midnight, a cry was heard. Behold, the bridegroom is coming. Go out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. So it's very interesting because in some manuscripts of the New Testament, it actually says bridegroom and his bride.
Ah, okay.
Oh, really?
Yes, bridegroom and his bride.
Uh-huh.
Anywhere, it doesn't make, I mean, it doesn't make any difference.
Okay.
What is very important that it's women that Jesus mentions here.
Mm-hmm.
Because he could have mentioned young men.
Mm-hmm.
Because this is very important because in that culture, for Easter, for instance, you needed to have 10 men in order to have Easter party.
Mm-hmm.
For wedding, it was exactly the same. You needed to have men in order to have a real wedding party. Wedding. Mm-hmm. But Jesus says, no. I want you to actually feel that the kingdom of God is so inclusive
mm-hmm.
that I even use the parables and I use female.
Mm-hmm.
There are many more parables that Jesus used female when we talk about the lost coin. Who
sure.
was the one who lost the coin?
It was a woman.
It was a woman.
Right.
There are many more parables that Jesus uses women in his parables. So Jesus is so inclusive. He says,
sure.
It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter. And for Jews of that time, mm-hmm. it was a little bit strange mm-hmm. to hear about women. But anyway, so what do you learn about Jesus in this parable?
Well, for me, what really stood out was that the fact that others had asked mm-hmm. when they had run out of oil, the others had asked, and to me, they said no. And the reason in the Bible it doesn't say that they just said no. Mm-hmm. They said no because there wouldn't be enough for the both of us. So it's mm-hmm. not saying that I don't want to give you any. The point is, if I give you some, it's not enough. It's not. Yeah, yes. I don't have any.
So. Excellent point.
So I thought maybe we could elaborate on that, because I just wanted to know
why it needs to yeah. be a personal experience. I always thought that was a really interesting point. Kind of mm-hmm. the biggest point for me in the story actually is just that it needs to be personal, because the other thing is that they all had oil to begin with. Mm-hmm. Like, it's not like they had none, because mm-hmm. you know, each person had yes. theirs, and then the five had extra.
Yes.
So I thought that was interesting, because it's not like they had a false sense of security, because oh well, I have some, like, is it enough, can I get into the wedding with just this little bit, I don't know. And I think they're hoping maybe that mm-hmm. he'll come in a time that they'll still have oil left over.
Yeah.
But the other ones were looking ahead and having faith, but it was something that they got mm-hmm. hold of themselves.
So, and by the way, this is an object that I brought from Israel last
nice.
Time when I was in Israel.
Wow. Wow.
Exactly. And this is exactly what we are talking about. This
wow.
is the lamp.
All right.
This is exactly the lamp. That, I mean, not this, definitely not this lamp. Because it's not very, it's very contemporary.
It's and not the, that old yet.
It's not at all. No.
Is it really that tiny though?
No. It wasn't this tiny. It was okay. much bigger, okay. much yeah. larger. This is just a miniature copy of the lamp.
So this is not the lamp from the Bible?
It's not the lamp. It's not the lamp that they use there. But this is what we are talking about today. So, and the oil, it was very significant to right. have it ready. And they also had some extra. Containers,
mm-hmm. uh-huh.
extra. So they would pour their oil uh-huh. so that the oil could continue burning. So this is what they apparently forgot. Mm-hmm. And or this is what
they didn't have.
Exactly. Not even forget, but didn't have.
Didn't have.
Because they were not as wise.
Yeah.
As the other ones.
Prepared, as prudent.
Well, there is something else that stuck out here, because we're contrasting it with the previous parable. Mm-hmm. And I felt like the previous parable dealt with relationships with others, and this one dealt with relationship with God, because, you know, the bridegroom said, I don't know you. So if he didn't know them, maybe they didn't know him either.
This is probably the point that we need to emphasize. Yeah.
So it's almost saying that all the girls started at the same time, and then
with the same resources.
Exactly, with the same resources. But I don't think that the girls that had more, like, purposely, you know, they purposely learned more on their own, and then mm-hmm. it became more than the other girls. But mm-hmm. then only when the time came, they had already had this prepared. So it's almost like they were just being normal, paying attention to the small things, and then growing their faith, growing their love. Mm-hmm. And the rest of them were like, oh, I have enough to keep up with them, so I'm going to do the same thing. Mm-hmm. But the point is, how much do you have that's going to last in the long run? And at that point, you can't share. When we come to the end, we can't share mm-hmm. what we've learned at the last minute and say, oh, learn this now, and now you'll be saved.
That's right.
It doesn't work like that.
I think the oil has to have something to do with relationship.
Exactly.
Because, you know, you can't give somebody your relationship with God.
Exactly.
They have to have
exactly.
their own relationship.
That's exactly mm-hmm. what it
so.
Is.
So in the first parable, we learned that Jesus talks about sharing and just taking care of those who are around us
mm-hmm.
by sharing the gospel that we have.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we will
but
talk
this
about
one
that gospel.
Can't share.
And this one, we can share, mm-hmm. but if we share, we will not have it. But what he's talking about here, now it's your turn, because you have been shared.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
We are equally now, mm-hmm. equal now.
Exactly.
So I want to know you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We need to take this short break. Don't forget to share your thoughts about today's question. What are some ways that we can personally share the gospel on a daily basis? We are looking forward to your comments. Let us know what you think, and your comment will be read here in the studio. You can post your thoughts on Facebook or by texting us to us at 707-210-75. Welcome back to Cross Connection. The story of the Word of God sets our hearts on fire. And we couldn't even stop talking about it.
Even during the break.
During the break, it was all about the parable about 10, 10 ladies. And we actually, we would like to reemphasize it one more time, because it is very important for us to understand that the first parable talks about this responsibility that is given to us. And second parable is reemphasizing the importance of having those close relationships with the bridegroom who is coming.
Amen.
Isn't it?
Amen.
And
exactly.
That is why he said, I want to know you.
Yes.
And those who don't have oil, I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. I don't know you.
Yes.
And again, this is what is also important, to look at this parable in the light of Matthew chapter 24, when he talks about no one knows, because it's the very last verse of this parable says, watch therefore, for you do not know when I will come back.
Yes. So I feel like the four that were not wise were almost presumptuous in thinking that they knew that they had enough.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
You know, because it's almost like they assumed when he was coming, because like, oh, I have this much, it must be enough. You know.
This is great, because the following parable actually talks about exactly the same thing.
All right. Yes.
Okay, so let's get to our following parable. And Elisa, if you could just shortly summarize this parable for us, and then we will read a few verses from this parable.
Okay, so master was going on a trip, and he called his servants, and he said, I'm going to entrust you each with certain talents. So he gave the first servant 5 talents, and the second one 2, and the third one 1. And so he went away on his trip, and the first one immediately went and started working with it, and he doubled it, so he got another 5. And then the one that had 2 talents went and made another 2, so he doubled it as well. But the third one was thinking, this guy, he's like kind of a terror in my life. That's what it says in the verse. And I need to just go hide it, because he's going to ask for it when he gets back. So he comes back, the master comes back, and he asks, you know, let's see what you did. And so they show him, you know, the 5 had 5, and he said, you doubled what you had before. You were faithful and you did well.
Yeah, let's read this verse, actually. It's verse 21. His Lord said to him, and Jennifer, if you could read for us this verse.
Sure. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things, and I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord.
Okay, and what about the second one? So it was the one with 5 who doubled, who had 10 now.
Yeah, and the second one, the same. He also doubled it. He started with 2, and he had another 2. And the master says the same thing to him.
The same thing,
exactly the same. And then he comes to the third one, and he asks him, you know, where's your talent? He said, well, I know what kind of man you are, and I was thinking, you're just gonna want, you take what's not yours. So I just went and hid it in a hole somewhere, I think is what he said.
And what is the response of servant? Yeah, verse 26.
Of the servant?
Yeah, no, of the master, sorry.
You wicked, lazy slave. You knew that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have put my money in the bank, and on my arrival I would have received my money back with interest. And then he says, take away from him even the little that he has, like the little I gave him originally, and cast him out, because for to everyone who has, more shall be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who does not have, even what he does have shall be taken away. Throw out the worthless slave into the outer darkness, in that place where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth.
Wow. Okay, okay. To be honest, this parable is very dangerous.
Yes.
Yeah.
Very dangerous. Yeah. Because this parable, reading this parable, we can think that, again, that we talked about it, that Jesus is examinator.
Yes.
Yeah.
He just gives you an exam. Here is like, this is something for you, this is something for you, this
waiting
is something for you.
Fall for...
And then I will follow up.
Mm-hmm.
Is this what you feel from this parable?
Not me.
Okay.
Not me.
Okay.
I mean, what I got out of this was that, you know, this servant absolutely had no trust for the employer, none. You know, he thought that the employer was basically like a crook. And if you are going to have a relationship with God and, you know, make a decision for Him, why would you do so if you think that God is a crook and He can't be trusted? And so basically, it's the same, you know, story again. I don't know you, you don't know me, you know, we don't have a relationship. And so that's what I felt, you know, came through here. It wasn't that the employer was a bad person. It was that the servant just didn't know who the employer was.
But I do find what the master or the employer said a little bit confusing, because when he said, you know that I take what I, what is not mine. Mm-hmm. And then I don't, what does that even mean?
Okay. And, yeah.
Well, I could I assume?
Please.
When he said to give something that is not ours, is, I would say, is our lives, because we, it's not ours because God has given us the life. So for me, this has changed so much from the oil, because with the oil, it was already there from the beginning of the story. But this is an investment.
Something that he gave.
Let's think of this in terms of like Wall Street. Or, you know, bankers, let's go there, because that's exactly where this is coming from. If someone was to give you a lot of money, would you just keep the money and do nothing with it? Or are we going to try to invest and develop more money? And that's how I'm thinking about it.
This is very good. In fact, we need to actually look at this parable also in the context. Because remember, what was the message of Jesus to the people who were... Pharisees at that time. In fact, in previous chapter, in Matthew chapter 23, he talks about, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, because you know all the gospel, you know all the laws and all the commandments. You're entrusted with a lot of knowledge.
Wow.
How do you use your knowledge? You shut the temple for Gentiles. You stopped giving, you stopped even supporting, like taking care of the poor people. You do whatever you want to do. Because even though I entrusted you with a lot, because you just, what did you do? What did you ultimately do?
He buried it in the ground.
Nothing at all, yeah. Okay, what is the gift that God gave you?
I would say His Son, you know? He gave us the opportunity to have eternal life.
Yeah. What did the death of Son give you?
Forgiveness.
Eternal life.
A chance to be redeemed.
Redemption.
Yeah.
Forgiveness.
Yeah.
The choice.
Yeah.
The forgiveness. The choice. Freedom.
Yeah.
Because redemption itself, it's since I set you free, redemption.
Sure.
I set you free. He set us free from all those things. So what is our responsibility then? According to the same parable.
To share that with those who are around us. Those who we come in contact with. That's what our job is, because we know what it is. And don't we want others around us to feel the same way?
Sure.
To
understand
the sacrifice and the investment that has been put into our lives? Wouldn't we want others to know about that?
Yeah.
Wow, this is good. This is excellent, because we are moving into the right direction.
Right.
So in the first parable, Jesus talks about the faithful servant and not so faithful servant.
Right.
And then he says, if you're faithful, you will be taking care of everybody. Second parable, he talks about five ladies, he talks about this very important truth that you need to be so close with the bridegroom so that when he comes, he says,
personally.
I know you.
You know him.
And then in the third parable, we read about, you're entrusted with something. I gave to you my son who is more than five talents.
Yeah.
By the way, five talents, one talent is 15 years of work.
Wow.
6,000 days of work.
That was a lot of money.
Five times 15, it's about 85.
Right.
85 years of work, maybe something very close, if I did my math right, 80. Yeah, so this is huge. By the way, do we have comments on Facebook?
We sure do, actually.
Sure, excellent.
So people were answering the question, what are some ways that we can personally share the gospel on a daily basis? So Isolin says, share personal experiences as well as the experiences of others I am close with. I see all the faces light up when I can tie someone else's challenge with something I have experienced and share with that person how God pulls me through, and then hear that person say, please remember me in your prayers.
Excellent.
We have Caitlin saying, the best thing we can do is reflect the life of Christ in all that we do. If we do not act and talk in a way that glorifies God, it is difficult for others to connect with Him. When you treat others with God's love and compassion, that can be the key to bring people closer to Him.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much, Caitlin and
Iselin.
Iselin, yes. Thank you so much for your comments. In fact, after a short break, we will continue talking about this exactly. This is very important.
Yes.
So don't go anywhere. If you have your computer nearby, now is the perfect time to go online and answer our question. What are some ways that we can personally share gospel on a daily basis? And we also want to hear from you through text at 707-210-75. And if you have your cell phone in your pocket or in your hand, you have no excuse. We will be back in the studio after a short break. Welcome back to Cross Connection, and you don't have excuses not to join our discussion. So thanks for your comments. And I would like to immediately jump to our fourth parable, and I would like to start with the picture. I would like all of you to look at this picture now. Mm-hmm. On this picture, you see a sheep and a goat. And when I was in Israel last time, we were told to differentiate sheep and goat. It wasn't very easy, I have to admit. And then one of the gentlemen, he was the one who was taking care of those, and he said, if you want to really identify who is who, you need to look them in the eyes.
Oh, and I was like, really?
What?
Why?
Okay.
How? Why? Really? So I looked them in the eyes, and I didn't see anything either. So what is basically happening? There are not so many, they're pretty much the same in real life. Pretty much the same. And there are a few distinctions that you can see, but they're pretty much the same. So in the next parable, which is very important, so bear this in mind. And the next parable, it says, starting with verse 31, and Jennifer, if you could read for us verse 31 to verse 36.
When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them one from another as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. And he will set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. Then the king will say to those on his right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, you gave me drink. I was a stranger, you took me in. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me.
Wow. And then everybody is like, when were you in prison? And then he says, whatever you do to what does he say?
Whatever you do to the least of these.
Yeah, in verse 40. Mm-hmm. Assuredly I say to you,
inasmuch as you did to one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me.
And Jesus talks about himself. No, yes.
Mm. I think it's interesting that neither group knew that they had done that. Like, it's not just the first group were like, oh, yeah, of course we had it so under control. We knew what we were doing. We were totally helping out. They didn't know either. And the ones that didn't do anything didn't know they hadn't done anything. But I do think it's really interesting that the ones that had reached out, they didn't know it was Christ that they were ministering to.
Mm-hmm.
So what does that say about their relationship with God? They were just trying to do it because he'd asked them, not because they were trying to impress or get on
because
the good side.
Because their life had been changed or their nature had changed.
It was almost innate.
Yes.
There is a great novel by a Russian writer, Leo Tolstoy. Mm. The novel is called Where Love Is, Their God Is Also. Yes. And I will share the summary or the adaptation of this story in our conclusion. Mm-hmm. So don't go anywhere, it's very interesting. and we will have a blog post on our Facebook, on our webpage, which is very fascinating. Where love is, there God is.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
It's not vice versa. It can be interchangeable, of course. Yeah. Where God is, there is love. Mm-hmm. But if you love, there is always God. Yeah. If there is God, there is always love.
Yes.
It was
you know,
way.
It's like, I feel like we're just rereading like the first two commandments over and over again in all these parables. Mm-hmm. Well, the commandments that Jesus pointed out, love God, love your neighbor. It's just like over and over again, we're seeing it, you know, through all the parables. Mm-hmm. It's like a thread woven through.
Beautiful. So what do people have to say about this main question that we have? How can we then, because now we see this fourth parable, it actually tells us what it really means to share the gospel.
Well, we have Lawrence who says, we can share it through music and personal testimonies. We can share our, and our gospel through that way.
Exactly.
Another Edwin says, give timely gospel message to people at appropriate times.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And Melissa says, I was thinking about this question actually today, and I thought to make little notes of scriptures daily to my children and put them in places like their lunch boxes or their school books so they can find them.
That's a great
and
idea.
See God's promises and see how much God loves them.
Absolutely.
Amen.
Wow, this is great. This is what I'm going to do with my wife.
Great.
Or maybe she will do it with me.
Yes, yes.
This is excellent.
Yes.
And it will also help us to memorize the scripture, because we want the word of God to abide in us. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Thank you to them for sharing, Melissa, Edwin, and Lawrence.
Thank you very much. Yeah, we really appreciate it. So this is beautiful how this Jesus describes what it really means.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Not to know when the kingdom is coming, but at the same time, advance this kingdom and preach the gospel of the kingdom.
Be caring about everyone around. I mean, it specifically says exactly what they did.
Exactly. Exactly.
Around.
Okay, let's just wrap it up, because we don't have enough of time. Mm-hmm. We have only 4 minutes left, and let me ask you the question that I usually ask. So what did you learn today? And Jennifer, what did you learn today?
So what I learned was, you know, God cares about how we treat others, and God wants to have a relationship with us. So, you know, like I said, I think in the four parables is like a gold thread woven through all of these. It's, you know, love God, love your neighbors.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't know when God is coming, so you need to do it all the time.
Beautiful, beautiful. Elisa?
Just to not be focused on the reward, because if you think, oh, this is the reason I'm doing this thing, it will take the value of it away. Like, the point was to be in a relationship, to be caring for those around you, to be doing your best every day. Not like, I mean, it's kind of like, you know, you have a test, like, on the 18th of this month, you know, or whatever, mm-hmm. and you're thinking, okay, well, I can just kind of do whatever I want, but I know I need to study on the 15th. Or on the 17th or whatever, it takes away, like, you should be doing your part every day and not feeling like it's just for an end, you know? Because you won't develop that relationship. It's just like, oh, I can do whatever I want until that time when I think this will happen, then
That's
I'll
right.
clean out my act, you know?
Okay, Jitesh.
We have a text message actually that came in.
Okay.
And doesn't have a name, but thank you for sharing. It says, sharing the scriptures, use anything from the morning to night, are perfect examples of God giving us life day by day as free air to live every day we wake up. So this ties in well with the same, how I was feeling, mm-hmm. is that every day we have a chance to share Jesus with someone else. And but one thing that I always have heard that has stuck with me is, we may be the only sermon and we may be the only Jesus that someone is going to experience in their life.
Mm-hmm.
And that's our job, to reflect that in everything that we do and in every person that we come in contact with. So thank you so much for sharing.
Okay, this is beautiful.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Because even though we don't know when the gospel is coming,
mm-hmm.
we still know that we are ready.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Not only that we can be ready, but we are ready, because God gave us His gift.
Mm-hmm.
What is the greatest gift? We talked about it. Salvation.
His Son, yeah.
Freedom. His Son. Because through His Son, we are free. We are cleansed. Mm-hmm.
We don't have to be a goat. We can be a sheep.
Yes, we are. We are. We are saved.
Right.
And once you're saved, you're given this talent, you're given this gospel, what is your responsibility?
To share
in God's
it.
Eyes.
Exactly.
Yep, to share it.
Beautiful. You know, there is a line that is attributed to Mother Teresa.
Mm-hmm.
Teresa. Thank you so much for correcting me. It says, preach gospel everywhere, anytime, wherever you can, to anyone.
Mm-hmm.
And if it's needed, use your words.
Wow. Yeah, I love
Amen.
That.
Amen.
Amen.
That's exactly what it is.
This is what Jesus concludes. This is how Jesus concludes His message.
Yeah.
He says, you know, I told you in one parable, second parable, third parable, but let me tell you, this is what the quintessence, mm-hmm. the fifth element, the last element of the gospel is. This is what I want you to do.
So what you're trying to say is, we all have what it takes.
We all are given those gifts.
We have the gifts.
We have those talents.
We need to just develop them.
Absolutely.
Amen.
Do we have the talents?
By using them.
Yes.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Exactly.
By using sharing.
Exactly.
Sharing not just by words, but by action.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, I learned a lot today.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you, Elisa. Thank you, Jitesh. Thanks to everyone who was able to join us today. And we are looking forward to your comments and your questions, or just let us know how Cross Connection has affected your life. Contact us on crossconnection@hopetv.org. We want to hear from you. See you after a short break. Let me conclude with a story by the Russian writer Leo Tolstoy called Where Love Is, There God Is Also. Martin Avdeich was a shoemaker. He lived in a basement in a little room with just one tiny window. Martin had always been a good man. But as he grew old, he began to think more about God. One day Martin read the Gospels till very late and didn't notice how he fell asleep. In the dream, Christ appeared to him, saying, "Martin, I will visit you tomorrow." The next morning, Martin rose, lit the stove, put on the cabbage soup, put the water in the samovar, and sat down by the window to work. As he was sitting by the window, he kept anxiously looking out for Jesus. He was waiting a while, and then he said to himself, "I must be getting really crazy in my old age," and laughed at himself. Then Martin looked out again through the window and saw an old man named Stepanich who was shoveling the snow outside. He was weary and broken down. He didn't even have enough strength to shovel the snow. Martin went outside and said, "Come in, warm yourself in a little. You must be cold." Stepanich was very thankful. Martin filled two cups with hot tea and handed one to his guest. After one warm conversation, the older man left. Martin sat down again by the window to work on his shoes. Many people were passing by, and suddenly he saw a young woman in wooden shoes. She stood still near the window. Martin looked up at her and saw a poorly clothed woman with a child in her arms. She was standing by the wall with her back to the wind, trying to wrap up the child. She had nothing to wrap the baby in. Martin got up, went to the door, and cried, "Please, come inside. It's warm in here." The woman was astonished. Martin placed her next to the stove where she could get warm. He quickly brought out a bowl of hot soup with a piece of bread. "Sit down," he said. "Please eat, and I will entertain the little one. You see, I once had children of my own. I know how to handle them." The young woman told Martin that she was a soldier's wife, and it was 7 months since her husband was sent off. Martin went to the corner of his room and found an old coat. The woman looked at the coat, looked at Martin, and she burst into tears. Then she said, "May Christ bless you. My little child would have frozen to death." When the woman was leaving, Martin gave her some money so that she could buy some warm clothes. When he sat down to work again, he saw an old woman who stopped right in front of his window. She carried a basket with apples. While she turned, a little boy picked up an apple from the basket and was about to make his escape, but the old woman turned around and caught the youngster by his sleeve. The little boy was screaming and the old woman was scolding. Martin lost no time and rushed outside into the street. He took the boy by his arm and said, "Forgive him. For Christ's sake, he will never do it again." The old woman let him loose. Martin instructed the little boy to say that he was sorry, and with tears, this little boy began to ask forgiveness. "Good," said Martin. "Now here is an apple for you." And he got an apple from the basket and gave it to the boy. "You ruined them that way. The good for nothing. It doesn't work," said the woman. Martin looked at her eyes and smiled. "That is right according to our judgment, but not according to God's judgment. If he is to be whipped for an apple, then what do we deserve for our sins? The old woman was silent. Martin told her the parable of the ruler who forgave a debtor all that he owed him, and how the debtor went and began to choke the one he owed him. The old woman and the boy stood listening. When she was ready to leave and lifted the basket, the boy ran up and said, "Let me carry it for you." Side by side, they both passed along the street, and Martin stood motionless. He heard them talking all the time as they walked away. After working a little while, he put away his tools and took down the Gospels from the shelf. He started reading, and when he started reading, he heard this silent voice, "Martin, did you not recognize me? It is I." And then the old man with the shovel stepped forth from the dark corner. He smiled and soon vanished. "And this is I," said the voice. From the dark corner stepped forth the woman with her child. The woman smiled and the child laughed, and they left and they vanished again. "And this is I," continued the voice. Both the old woman and the boy with the apple stepped forward, both smiled and vanished. Martin rejoiced and began reading the gospel. "For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was stranger and you took me in. Inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these my brothers and sisters, you did it to me." And Martin understood that his dream did not deceive him, that Christ visited him that day. So please, accept everyone who is near to you as you would accept Christ himself. Until next week, stay connected with Jesus in your everyday life.